Hello, everyone. I'm Bhaskar Sridharan. I lead all of the AI, ML, and data processing services in AWS. I'm pretty excited today to have Greg from Canva. I would love Greg to introduce himself.
Thanks. Hi, I'm Greg. Nice to be here, Bhaskar.
Great to have you, Greg. Before we start, I would love to understand, what's Canva's vision for Gen AI, and how are you thinking about the overall vision?
We see generative AI sort of transforming the Canva from top to bottom, really. We think it's going to change visual communication. We're going to see Gen AI sort of linking the various components and aspects of Canva together to really make it easy for people to communicate visually, create awesome looking designs, and sort of just raise the bar of the designs that they produce on Canva.
Since the time Canva got onto AWS, how have you seen the evolution of Canva? Can you describe that for us?
Yeah, sure. So Canva's always been quite forward-looking in terms of our usage of AI and machine learning. So we did our first models, many years ago now, primarily in the search and recommendation space. So we've been training models on AWS using various technologies, EMR, Spark, SageMaker, Bedrock, and that sort of environment. But we've sort of done the full transformation. Our original models were sort of offline batch recommendation models. So, you know, you would run a daily run of producing recommendations to your users. And then we sort of transitioned to a real-time world where people would get real-time recommendations and various aspects of personalizing Canva itself. And then we sort of rode the generative AI wave and we added text to image in Canva, so generating images. And yeah, now we've got tools like Magic Write that are producing content in multiple languages. And really we've got a chat assistant and sort of we've sort of done the whole journey, and we use a lot of AWS services as we do that.
One of the things that are harder for companies in Gen AI space is moving from prototype to production is the selection of models. You have a plethora of models available now. We just announced Bedrock Marketplace, which has 100 plus Gen AI models. This is in addition to the models that we have on Bedrock from leading foundational model providers. How would you think about model selection? What is the advice that you would give for other companies trying to make the same journey that Canva has made so far?
Yes, it's the choice is great, but it can be a little bit overwhelming knowing where to start, and that's a real challenge that we find teams finding. They often will default to a model that they may have heard from another team or social media or something like that. So there's a sort of bias that people have naturally. So we have to sort of help them understand that there's sort of public leaderboards and things like that that they can look at and leverage. But really what we're trying to encourage and sort of the best practice that we have these days is try your best to compare models in sort of playgrounds and sort of do a little bit of vibe check. So you sort of try a few and see what works. Come chat to some of the sort of experts, maybe at AWS or my team. And then the really good thing is to sort of have an evaluation suite that sort of give you concrete metrics on what good looks like and how your performance characteristics are performing with the various models. But another thing that helps a lot is a sort of an abstraction layer between your code and the model backends, like through Bedrock. So the Converse API is an example of something that you provide that really helps. You know, you can have a configuration parameter to swap out from 3.5 Sonnet to 3.5 Haiku, and then you can kind of compare results. So in the early stages, we recommend just sort of having a few examples, having a play in the playground, sort of getting your vibe checks, just so that you kind of know what family of models that you might want to look at. And then as you sort of progress through the development lifecycle, it gets a bit more rigorous and you might have evaluation suites and you can see real metrics and you can make more hard cost accuracy trade-offs.
Now, coming back and rewinding to the days when you were prototyping these Gen AI applications to where you are now into production, this journey from prototype to production is not an easy one. Like, you know, Gartner predicts that 30% of the projects in prototyping phase fail and the remaining get into production. What is your advice for companies who want to move from GenAI applications that are actually in prototype phase and move them into production? I call the prototyping phase the act one of GenAI. The production is the act two. Like, so how do you get from act one to act two?
I think we're all still learning, if I'm completely honest. But yes, it is. It's actually very challenging. It's actually this. The GenAI technology makes it, it democratizes things quite easily. So it's actually quite easy to do very impressive things sort of from a zero to one. So you can build an impressive looking prototype that sort of works well on your laptop or something and demos well to your team. And then you think, oh, we're ready to go. And you might sort of go too quickly into production. And then as the real data comes through, you might get out of distribution inputs. And the model behavior is not what you expected at all. So that's challenging. So you need observability on that. And the other thing is, if you're not really knowing what metrics you're measuring, so you might just eagerly go into production. And then you're actually not sure on what good necessarily looks like, and you haven't thought about that yet, and you may have chosen the incorrect model for your use case, or your prompt engineering may not be good enough or appropriate. So there's a lot of things that you need to think about. We're still learning. We're dipping our toes into phase two. We do have live features in production, and I think evaluation suites really help us. Canva's got a lot of great observability tooling, fortunately, across our product. We've got a robust A-B testing system as well that can help this area. So you can use A-B testing as a bit of a crutch until you get robust evaluation suites, maybe with LLM judges, so that you can do human-like evaluation. But if you're unable to get there soon, a reasonable shortcut might be A-B testing in production, so you can compare two variants of your system. So I think this phase two, this act two, as you talk about, is the area where real investment is happening these days, and LLM ops tooling and evaluation suites and guardrails and the best practices, we're sort of still learning them all together. So it's difficult. It's even difficult for us at Canva, but I think my recommendation would be, if you can do anything, do evaluation suites.
That's awesome advice, right? Like, because when you look at taking these GenAI applications and putting them into production at scale, like you not only want to look at models, like you said, of course the cost of inference also matters, but then there is the whole data, which includes observability, and you can only improve things that you observe.
Yeah.
And then there is the guardrails and the trust piece that you spoke about, right? Bedrock guardrails that customers use for making sure that they can instill trust in their users and their customers. Right. So I think all four are pretty critical to get to act two of GenAI, I think.
Absolutely. And then it also gets even more complicated, because for each component that you have that might be generative or agentic, even if they're performing at 99%, once you start getting combinations of these systems interacting, the sort of cascading errors can be great. So it's really key to have observability between all of these things, and being able to observe and evaluate your overall system, not just individual pieces. So you have to be able to look at multiple levels of your system to understand what's going on. And you can build incredible things, but as you start composing these things, the behavior can be a bit challenging to keep eyes on. So it's very important to have sort of this observability, as you speak of, and an evaluation suite that can help you to make sure that the overall system is performing as expected.
I think you also touched upon something interesting too, Greg, which is going into act two of GenAI into production also requires the ability to take a complex workflow and then decompose them into smaller agentic workflows, and then being able to have an orchestrating agent, so to speak, that can put these agentic workflows together to achieve the complex workflow.
Exactly, right? Yes.
And this is one thing that we have heard from a bunch of our customers, and one of the reasons why we launched Bedrock's multi-agent collaboration for precisely this reason, which is to help customers get to production with complex workflows by decomposing them into smaller, simpler ones.
Yes, exactly. That's exactly the kind of thing you need. You need a framework that helps you coordinate these things and be able to evaluate the whole sort of agent as a workflow.
So, Greg, when we speak about moving from act one, which is prototyping, to act two, production, getting trust and responsible AI right in these GenAI applications is extremely critical. We definitely understand the criticality of it. We have heard from customers like you that they wanted Bedrock guardrails to be one of the key tools in implementing responsible AI and trust. How, from your experience on how you have dealt with moving from Canva, from prototyping to production, what are your thoughts on trust, responsible AI, and what other companies should be looking at when they move into production so that they can instill trust in their users and customers?
Absolutely, yes. Canva takes trust incredibly seriously. Our product is used at school and education facilities, so it's something that you can't skimp on. And it's definitely tempting to maybe skimp on this in the prototyping phase. And you actually sort of need to build it in from the beginning. So Canva spends a lot of time with moderation systems. So we use AWS recognition for a lot of that, as well as custom models that we have on our side. Our platform processes audio, video, textual content. So we've got a lot of different modalities of data that we need to moderate. And also out of range inputs and outputs. So having things like guardrails in place and wrapping trust around your systems is key. And it's fantastic that Bedrock guardrails is sort of there from the beginning. So it does make it a lot easier to think about that from the prototyping phase, so that when you go into production, you've got guardrails in place to make sure that not only that, you know, reduce hallucinations, but also to make sure that, you know, unsavory content isn't presented to users. And, you know, you've got inputs that you need to moderate, and you've also got outputs that you need to moderate. So it's something that you definitely want to spend a bit of time on right from the beginning if you can.
Where do you think we are headed with GenAI in the next 3 to 5 years?
I think we're going to see it become part of the regular life cycle in almost every product. It's going to touch every part of what we do. It's part of our engineering workflow, the software development lifecycle, and the tooling. So, you know, tools like QDeveloper and that. So it's right there in your IDE. So the engineers are going to get more familiar with these tooling, and not only necessarily AI specialists, but sort of it's going to become democratized for everybody. We're going to be developing these best practices, like you talk about in phase two, and sort of these evaluation suites might become far more commonplace, and they need to become far more commonplace. Just as unit testing is commonplace these days, that's the kind of the equivalent is possibly an evaluation suite. So it's going to be almost everywhere. I think our products are going to be composed of traditional software code, but a lot of these intelligent agents that can coordinate and orchestrate and in very intelligent ways, and it's going to make our systems more human, I think.
I agree.
Yeah.
And I think especially, you know, with the inflection point that we are in today, where everything with GenAI is done in a very compressed timeline, we have to be able to use tools that actually help us develop these GenAI applications in a much more compressed timeline. And clearly decomposing them into agents and agentic workflows, I think is going to be very critical to get to scale at production.
Yeah, I think it sort of rhymes with what we did with monoliths to microservices. It might be sort of these agents and workflows and like unit tests to make sure that your code is performing as necessary, and evaluation suites to make sure that your AI is performing as necessary. So it rhymes, and I think it's probably going to move that direction.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for your time, Greg. Really appreciate you spending time. And thank you very much for the candid conversation on how other companies can move from prototype to production. We love having you as our AWS customer. We love having you as Bedrock customer. And I'm definitely looking forward to having feedback from you on all of the great Bedrock launches that we have had.
Thank you so much. Looking forward to working more closely in future.